From the auditorium of America's fastest growing church, the Thomas Road Baptist Church in Lynchburg, Virginia, we present the Old Time Gospel Hour with Dr. Jerry Falwell.
Dr. Elmer Towns wrote, "The Thomas Road Baptist Church is people." And that's the ministry of Old Time Gospel Hour, reaching people with a saving gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. In a few moments, I'll be speaking on the subject, the end of the world. How near is it? This is a message on Bible prophecy, the coming of the Lord, the return of Christ, the end of the world. How near is it? I hope you'll stay for the full 1 hour today, as right from the church auditorium of Thomas Road Church, nearly 200 stations are carrying Old Time Gospel Hour right now. Seated with me here is the fellow who's going to be singing for you in just a few moments. His name is Doug Oldham. And Doug, I'm sure you have something relevant to the message today.
Well, I just may have to do a chorus of "The King is Coming" if you're going to preach
it. Amen. Well, with "The King is Coming" and my message on "How Near is the End," I have a feeling we'll keep most of our viewers for the next hour. Now back out into the main auditorium, and Jim Moon, our co-pastor, leads us in this great old hymn. Sing along with us, will you?
Congregation and choir, you may be seated. Standing just to my left, the Lynchburg Baptist College Chorale. We're very proud of them. They're going to sing for you right now. people said.
Amen.
That's great, young people. You know, every day we're getting letters from all over the country saying, send us a catalog, send us information on Lynchburg Baptist College. The reason for it, I think, is because LBC, now in its first year of operation, is offering something most colleges are not offering. All of our instructors are born-again believers. Jesus Christ is our theme. The local church is our emphasis. We have 305 students this year. We're expecting 1,000 this fall. And God only knows what's going to happen in the months and years ahead if Christ tarries his coming. Right now, we have a great big fellow from, well, last night he was in Akron, Ohio. Tonight he'll be in Indiana. And right now he's in Lynchburg, Virginia, Doug Oldham.
There's no other name so sweet as Jesus. No one ever cared so much for me as to shed his precious blood.
Sunday school and church this morning, Paula and I got to singing a song, and I'm just going to repeat it. Paula, I trust you're here somewhere. An old favorite, an old standard. There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see it afar.
There's a land that is fairer than day, and by faith we can see.
Well, when I was a kid, Dad used to come along toward the end of the day. Oh, maybe we'd be out in the garden. He liked to raise garden. About supper time, he'd come around. He'd say, "Hey, come on, boy, it's time to go home." I don't remember ever running away and saying, "I'm scared to go home with you." I always liked to go home with my dad. I still like to go home with my dad. There's just something about walking down the street with him. Brings a sense of joy and of satisfaction to me. I think it's the same way with a Christian. When it comes time for you and I to go home, there's no reason to fight it. No reason to get upset. Just going home to be with your Heavenly Father. Going to enjoy more than you've ever enjoyed before. Going to share in all that He's prepared for us. The song says, "Many times in my childhood, when we traveled so far, by nightfall, how weary I'd grow. Then Father's arm would slip around me so gently. He'd say, 'Come on, boy.' Well, it's time to go." Twilight is fading, life's day soon shall end. I get home sick the farther I roam. Ah, but my Father has led me each step of the way. Start to sing, "Amazing Grace." Oh, the King is coming, the King is coming. I just heard the trumpet sounding, and now His face I see. The King is coming, the King is coming. Well, praise God, He's coming. Trumpet sounding, and now His face I see. The King is coming, our King is coming. Well,
The end of the world, how near is it? We hear a great deal today about the end of the world. When is it going to come? Some have been so presumptuous as to set dates. And as a result, people have sold their worldly goods, gone to a mountaintop somewhere, and waited for the end of the world to come. Others have taught and preached that there will be no end, that everything will go on as it is. And both parties are wrong. According to the Word of God, this age as we know it today, this world as it is presently constituted, will indeed terminate. God has so designed His dispensations that when the fullness of time is come, the trump of God will sound. The dead in Christ shall rise first, and then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together with them in the air, in the clouds to meet the Lord in the air, and so shall we ever be with the Lord. As surely as we are gathered in this auditorium this morning, the Lord is coming again. When He comes, the church age will be concluded. The church will be gathered out. And then will begin the time called the day of Jacob's trouble, the tribulation period on this earth, continuing for 7 years, at the conclusion of which, according to the Word of God, the greatest war of all wars will be fought. The Battle of Armageddon will be fought. The blood will flow in the streets up to the bridles of the horses for 200 miles. Then, according to the Word of God, the golden age, the kingdom age, the millennium will begin, during which time for 1,000 glorious years we shall rule and reign with the Lord Jesus Christ as He sits down upon the throne of David in Jerusalem. Following the kingdom age, this is just a resume of Bible prophecy. Eternity begins. According to the Word of God, there'll be new heavens and new earth. God Himself will be in the midst of this great eternity. And all the saints of all the ages will inherit their inheritance, possess their possessions. We shall know as we are known. We shall know then, if we don't already, that the only thing in this world worthwhile is to know Jesus Christ personally. Simon Peter, in his second epistle, chapter 3, verses 10 through 14, wrote concerning those awful days that are still ahead for you and me. Beginning in chapter 3 of 2 Peter, verses 10 through 14, "But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise." Some have thought this means perhaps a nuclear blast. "And the elements shall melt with fervent heat." That's tremendous heat, isn't it? "The earth also and the works that are therein shall be burned up, seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved. What manner of persons ought ye to be in all holy conversation and godliness, looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to His promise, look for new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent, that ye may be found of Him in peace, without spot and blameless." More than 1,900 years ago, the angels announced the birth of Jesus with the promise, "On earth, peace, goodwill toward men." Over 19 centuries have passed, and yet there's no peace among the nations, no goodwill among men. Today we find ourselves in the midst of a society that knows more about hate and turmoil, malice and strife than any generation that has preceded us. Over 1,900 years ago, Jesus taught His disciples to pray, "Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, in earth as it is in heaven." And yet after 19 centuries, the will of God is not done in earth as it is done in heaven. Today there are those who hate God. The communists have taken over one third of this world, and they openly deny the very existence of God. We have on every hand those who are building what they call a new morality, denying the Word of God, refusing to believe the integrity of the Scriptures, denying the Christ of the Bible, denying the necessity of regeneration. They declare situation ethics to be the rule of the day. Whatever seems to be convenient and acceptable, they do that which is right in their own eyes. Over 1900 years ago, the first message Jesus sent from heaven after he ascended came through the mouth of the two men or the two angels at the open tomb, who said, "Why stand ye here gazing up into heaven? What's so miraculous about the ascension of the Lord back to the right hand of the Father?" This same Jesus who is taken up from you into heaven shall so come in like manner as you've seen him go. And yet after 19 centuries, this same Jesus has not come back. And the earth has not once again been graced with his presence in our midst. Over 1900 years ago, the Holy Spirit closed the Canaan of inspired scriptures with the last promise of our ascended Savior. That promise was, "Surely I come quickly, amen." Revelation 22. And yet more than 19 centuries have transpired, and he has not come, he is not here, and the world goes on seemingly on a headlong trail of destruction. Wars and rumors of wars, hatred, malice, nation against nation, kingdom against kingdom, sin runs rampant. And today you lock your doors when you go to bed at night for fear of some burglar or thief or murderer breaking in, murdering your family, and robbing what you have. We have not yet realized the fulfillment of the promises of God's Word about the coming utopia, the coming rest for the people of God. Why not? There's some who have a misconception of what the coming of the Lord is all about. I've heard men preach funerals, and as they preach the funeral, by what they were saying, they were indicating that death for the Christian is the second coming of Christ. That cannot be supported by Scripture. The second coming of Christ and the death of a believer are two separate instances, because the Bible clearly teaches that when he comes, the dead in Christ shall rise first. Meaning that they died first and the Lord came and resurrected or raptured them out of the graves, and that's yet future. The cemeteries are filled with people who have not yet learned the fullness of the meaning of the resurrection. A few weeks ago on Easter Sunday, I preached on Where Are the Dead? And I said in that message that when a Christian dies, he goes immediately into the presence of the Lord. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 8, "For to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord." I said further that an unsaved man dies today in his sins, and he goes immediately into hell, where there's weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. Someone wrote and said, "How can that be? How can it be so that a Christian goes into the presence of the Lord, a lost man goes into hell immediately without soul sleep, knowing that there's yet to come a resurrection day?" Yes, there is. But on that resurrection day, according to the Word again, the dead in Christ, their bodies shall be raised to be reunited with their souls and spirits already in the presence of God. The body is in the grave. The body has gone back to dust from whence it came. But the Bible says one day, this mortality will give way to immortality. This corruption shall give way to incorruption. In a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trump, the dead shall be raised incorruptible, and we shall be changed. That is, those of us who are alive and remain. So the graves, those dead bodies, and those who are alive and remain, shall in a moment, the twinkling of an eye, receive glorification. Now, what does that mean? Well, that means we're going to have a body just like his. We have spirits and souls now that are absolutely separate from body. They just happen to be tabernacle in this flesh right now. When the Lord comes, that'll all be corrected. We'll receive a glorified body. 1 John 3:2, beloved, now are we the sons of God? It doth not yet appear what we shall be, but we know when he, Christ, shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. We're going to be just like him. 33 years old, I don't know. Nobody else really knows. All I know is our body will be just like his. No death, no sickness, no sorrow, no need of rest. You won't have to go to bed at night, lock your doors. An eternal, glorified body just like his, and the spirit and soul already with God, and the body in the grave will be reunited on that resurrection morning and will be with him together forever without the limitations of time and space ever again. So the second coming of the Lord is not death. There are two separate instances. Some believe that the coming of the Holy Spirit on the day of Pentecost is the second coming of Christ as referred to in the scriptures. But very clearly, when our Lord went away, he said, it's expedient for you that I go away, for if I go not away, the Comforter will not come. The Holy Spirit, the Parakletos, was called by our Lord the Comforter. And when he comes, Jesus said, he will guide you into all truth. Jesus formerly had said, I am the truth. So he said, the Holy Spirit will guide you into more knowledge about me. And he will be the administrator of the church until I come. So for these last nearly 2,000 years, the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of the glorified Christ, has been on this earth, saving sinners, guiding believers, indwelling the saints, administrating his church, preparing the stage for that next great momentous event on God's calendar when the clouds shall break open and the voice will be heard and the trumpet will sound and the grave shall open, the dead in Christ shall rise first, and then we who are alive and remain shall be caught up together. I was riding behind a car the other day, obviously driven by a Christian, and on the back it said, in the event of rapture, this car will self-destruct. When the Lord comes, every saved driver is going to be caught away. I wouldn't want to be in the middle of the highway. It's bad enough being out there with drivers behind the wheels. When the Lord comes and the drivers are taken out, something tremendous is going to happen. Can you imagine riding in an airliner with a saved pilot? I'm glad George is saved, but I wouldn't want to be a sinner on board with George Faith when the Lord comes, because that 414 is going to be riding along without a pilot up front. Now, I believe that as much as I believe I'm in this pulpit today. When the Lord comes, every saved person is going to be caught out, and the coming of the Holy Spirit was not and is not the coming of the Lord. The second coming of Jesus Christ is something else. There are some who teach that the conversion experience is the second coming of Christ, that he came the first time, lived on this earth 33 years, was crucified, buried, rose from the dead. And his second coming is every time a sinner gets saved, he comes into that sinner's heart. Well, thank God for conversion. We believe you must be born again. We do believe that Christ in the person of the Holy Spirit enters a heart, enters a life when a person is genuinely saved. But that's not the second coming. Last night I had the joy of leading a dear mother to Christ. I explained to her the plan of salvation. God had blessed her with 3 children. And she was a church member and a good moral person, a wonderful provider, and she'd done a mammoth job in raising her boys up. But as I explained the plan of salvation to her, she was able to clearly see that I have religion, but I don't have salvation. I think the curse of America today is church membership without Christ, religion without conversion. You can have a lot of religion up in this head of yours, but if you don't have Christ in your heart, you're not a child of God. But that's not the second coming. The second coming is not that. Some think that every time Christ comes in providential happenings and through tragedies and so on, that's his second coming. But all of these are just the attempts of men to circumvent and get around the fact that one day the clouds are going to open. One day Jesus is coming, and we who live in these last days believe that his coming is imminent. As Doug Oldham was singing, "Going Home, and Then the King is Coming," I could sense all over this audience that blood pressure was moving up a little bit. and blessings were beginning to flow just a little bit. Why does that happen? Everywhere we go, in television, radio rallies, when Doug sings "The King is Coming," smiles light up the audience. And the blessing of God, you know why? Because Christians are more aware now than I've ever known them to be that the coming of the Lord is imminent. Jesus is coming soon. There's a rustling in the mulberry bushes. There's a moving of God in the undercurrent. Something is happening today that hasn't happened in my ministry. There's an awareness of the imminency of Christ's return. There are four words I want to give you as we talk about the end of the age. The end of the age. Let's turn, please, to Matthew chapter 24. In Matthew's Gospel, chapter 24, the disciples came to the Lord one day and asked him the pointed question, when are we going to see the end of the world? Verse 1, Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to him for to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said unto them, see ye not all these things? Verily I say unto you, there shall not be left here one stone upon another that shall not be thrown down. And as he sat upon the Mount of Olives, the disciples came unto him privately, saying, tell us, when shall these things be? And what shall be the sign of thy coming and of the end of the world? Better translated, and of the end or consummation of the age. When will the age, the church age, or the age of the Gentiles be concluded? And then Jesus spends the rest of this chapter called the Olivet Discourse telling them how to know when the age is about to conclude. Now that's not my message today. But very briefly, if you were to read the 24th chapter of Matthew, you'd find that Jesus answered, saying, first, take heed that no man deceive you. There'll be many Christ religionists coming in that day saying, I'm Christ, follow me, we're the only ones. The first thing he says is, watch out for religious deception. Sincerity is not enough. The devil's sincere, but he's not saved. Adolf Hitler was sincere, but he's in hell. Sincerity is not enough. You've got to be sincerely right. You can be sincerely wrong. Well, how do I know what to believe? If one person preaches this, another preaches that. Find out what the Word of God says and believe that. This book is true. You don't have to read books about the Bible necessarily, but if the Word of God says it, it's so. If Jerry Falwell disagrees, if your pastor disagrees with the Word of God, your pastor's wrong. If your religion disagrees with this book, your religion is wrong. This book is true. Let God be true and every man a liar. More than that, wars and rumors of wars. That means hot wars and cold wars. Bloody wars, Vietnam, so on. Ideological clashes, the Cold War. This ism against that ism. Capitalism versus communism, etc. Pestilence, famine, earthquakes, and all that kind of thing. And over later in the chapter, you find in verses 32, 3, and 4, the regathering of Israel, the budding of the fig tree. Thank God the Jews are going back home. Somebody asked the late Dr. DeHaan, what's the greatest indication of the Lord's soon return? He said, the Jewish nation. The Jews have gone back home. 3 million of them there now in Israel. We were there in January. One of the greatest signs of the Lord's return is the budding of the fig tree. Tonight in this service, I'm speaking on the return of the Jews. And I'm looking forward to sharing with you some of the ways that we know the coming of the Lord is upon us. Routineness. In the days of Noah, so shall it be as in the days of the coming of the Son of Man. Eating, drinking, marrying, giving in marriage, so on and so on. All of this is in the Olivet Discourse. The signs of his return. But listen. The coming of the Lord, that next great event on God's calendar, first involves a return of the same Jesus who ascended from the Mount of Olives over 19 centuries ago. The angel said, why stand you here gazing? This same Jesus, not another, this same Jesus shall so come in like manner as you've seen him go. What's going to be the end of the age as we know it today, the church age? There's got to be a reappearance, a return of the same Jesus who walked this earth 2,000 years ago. When he returns, the church age will be over. And I believe that will indicate the last preaching of the gospel of grace as we preach it today. Further, I believe that when he comes, every saved person is going up. That's the second word, resurrection. What's going to happen when Jesus comes? When he comes, well, it's going to be a hot time in the old town. The graves are going to open everywhere. Dr. Ross, I've told you about it. My college professor years ago used to say, I've asked the Lord when I die, when the Lord comes, to let me be out in the graveyard where I've buried my loved ones, mama, daddy, all the rest who've died in Christ, because I want to see those graves open and look to the old devil in that instant and say, ha ha, I told you so. The death and the grave cannot hold its foe, because Jesus rose from the dead, and when he comes again, because I live, ye shall live also, he said. He's going to raise the saved dead. Every saved person, whether on fire for God or maybe a little lukewarm, every saved person is going to be caught up. Then the next word is the word rapture. By the way, the word rapture is not a Bible word. It's an English word that describes a Bible happening. The word rapture simply means a translating, a snatching up and out. And that describes what I was talking about a moment ago. All the little babies are going up. They won't be in nurseries during the tribulation period, because all the babies are going up when the Lord comes. There's a host of biblical evidence to prove that little children who have not reached the age of accountability go immediately into the presence of the Lord at death, and likewise when he comes the second time. So whether you're saved or not, Dad and Mom, that little child of yours is going up if the Lord comes soon. That means that if you want to spend eternity with that little one, you'd better get right with the Lord. I brought a man to church with me this morning who's seated here in the audience. He got saved 2 weeks ago back here. He said, you know, I called my mother in Tennessee to tell her I got saved. And after I told her, he said, she was so happy and shouting and carrying on. She said, well, now you can just go on and die if you want to. You'll go where Daddy is. He said, well, I didn't want to do just that, Mama. I'm just glad to be saved. But she was just so glad. What she meant was, I'm not worried about you anymore. I know you're ready to meet the Lord. She'd been praying for him. Salvation is real. And when the Lord comes, there's going to be a catching away of saved people, alive and dead. The dead first, then those who are alive and remain. It's going to be the greatest event this world has ever known. For some, however, 2 Peter chapter 3, he'll come as a thief in the night. It'll be a terrible day for the unsaved. The unsaved will be left behind to face the awful tragedies of the tribulation hour. But thank God for those who know the Lord. When he comes, it'll be the grandest and most glorious reunion the world has ever known. Will we know each other in heaven? Why, of course we will. We'll not only know each other, we'll know everybody. We'll have cognition as well as recognition. We'll know as we are known. And I think we'll spend the first 10,000 years getting better acquainted with Jesus, and the next 10,000 years getting acquainted with our loved ones and friends who've gone on ahead of us, and meeting a few fellows along the way like D.L. Moody and Martin Luther and Charles Haddon Spurgeon. Us Baptists will probably run to Spurgeon first, but we'll have a long time just meeting and getting acquainted with those who've gone on ahead of us. The next word, the last word, is the word reward. The end of the age means not only the resurrection, the rapture of God's own, but it means immediate appearance before the judgment seat of Christ. If you haven't read 1 Corinthians chapter 3 lately, you ought to read it when you get home today. According to the word of God, when Jesus comes and catches away the church, bodies and spirits reunited in the clouds, that very moment we will come before not the great white throne judgment, but before the judgment seat of Christ, there to be judged according to our works, our faithfulness, our loyalty to Christ. There's a little 95-year-old lady here this morning. You may have mentioned her already. I don't know if you did or not, Doug. She came here in a wheelchair, blind. Her husband died 1 year ago today. She came on one of the Sunday school buses from Hurt, Virginia. I can think of many whose funeral services I've conducted. I can think of many who physically have been racked with pain, who've gone through every kind of ordeal. Young, old, rich, poor, every saved person in their new, wonderful, and glorified bodies will stand before the judgment seat of Christ and will give an account of how we have ministered and labored for him since we've known Christ. Some will suffer great loss. wood, hay, stubble will mark the works of many who've died with nothing but leaves for the Master, never led a soul to Christ, never entered into a life of intercession and prayer, never known the power of a Spirit-filled life, never really been dedicated and totally surrendered to the Lord. And others, gold, silver, precious stone, will characterize your works, works that endure. You've been a faithful, loyal servant for Christ, and you'll hear him say, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter thou into the..."